This is easily the best 3D printer that Creality has ever made. It has a large, above average 300mm cubed build volume, multi-material support, a solid premium build, the user interface finally feels reliable and smooth, and for the features you're getting, it's at a really competitive price point. If I was an engineer over at Creality, I'd be proud, I'd be celebrating this machine. Which is why it's a bit unfortunate that as soon as Creality caught up, and maybe even overtook the competition, the game completely changed overnight. Let me explain. The K2 Pro is a big pooper. Every time it needs to change filament colors, it has to extrude some material out the backside to clear out the nozzle. I recycle my printer waste into different things, but most people don't. If you're clever, you can design and print around these limitations to minimize wastage, but you still be wasting. So Bamboo Lab just released their H2D, a huge dual nozzle printer that can cut wastage by up to 70%. Snapmaker then broke Kickstarter records with the U1 that can almost entirely eliminate waste. Prusa then posted a picture, and then Bamboo Lab was so spooked about the thought of being upstaged that they prematurely announced the H2C, right after also releasing the H2S. Anyway, that whole situation meant that the K2 Pro has mostly flown under the radar for a lot of people. 3D printers that poop have only been around for a few years, but it appears they might quickly be seen as outdated. Which is a shame because I've really enjoyed my time testing this thing, but I still do think that because of its price point and all of its features, but mostly the price point, the K2 Pro is going to be a perfect printer for a whole lot of people. Thank you to Creality for really spoiling me here with some accessories, the SpacePi X4 filament dryer, the K2 Pro combo itself, their new air purifier apparently designed specifically for 3D printers, and also some filaments. The air purifier and the SpacePi X4 are honestly pretty cool, but so that I don't bore those of you who don't care about those right now, I made separate short videos for both of them that you can check out whenever you like. Anyway, let's get into it. This machine is quite heavy, so I definitely recommend getting someone to help you lift it. And inside the box are a heap of things that you'd probably expect, like instructions and stickers, sample filament, screws and tubes, some basic assembly and maintenance tools, a filament buffer, a power cable for the wrong country. This might be because mine is a review unit. And if I knew this was the screen, I probably wouldn't have dropped it. Ouch. There's also whatever this is, and the multi-material system, also known as the CFS, Creality Filament System. Anyway, now it's time to release the CFS, which was mounted in here very securely, maybe a bit too securely, honestly. I struggled getting some of these weirdly placed screws out, but I guess it is better than shipping damage. And here it is. There's exposed tubing on the bottom, which is great to see. What I think is a filament cutter, I'm not too sure. Two connectors, one connects to the printer and the other connects to the buffer or chains to another CFS. A separate power socket, again, I'm not sure. The instructions just don't mention this. And while I'm talking about annoying things, look at all of these stickers. Some came off easy, some didn't. And this one, who's ever going to see this here? Also, I don't understand why the USB port is all the way back here, but this is all just nitpicking. On the back of the printer, you'll find an Ethernet port, the poop chute, and some mounting holes for the side spool holder if you don't want to go with the CFS. After a few more screws, attaching the screen and connecting the PTFE tubes, wiring, and buffer, it was finally ready to turn on. Overall, a pretty straightforward assembly experience. All CorexY printers these days have a pretty similar assembly and setup experience, so yeah. And again, please note that it's big, heavy, and awkward, so please get someone to help you out if you can. The touchscreen setup process was the same as always. Choose a language, connect to the internet, then it runs through some automated testing and calibration for 10 minutes. You know how it goes. I thought about showing a little tour of the UI, but honestly, every manufacturer seems to have copied each other into oblivion. It's literally all the same now, so instead, a free 3D printing tip just for you is that the foam padding makes excellent cat beds. Currently, his favorite seems to be the foam from the Centauri Carbon. The K2 Pro bed seems a bit too big for him, so he hasn't really taken to it, and his least favorite is the cardboard padding from the Core One, but I'll keep you updated if any of this changes. Taking a closer look at the CFS, it's very similar to other solutions like Bamboo Lab's AMS or AnyCubic's ACE system, but with a few small changes and additions, like a humidity and temperature display, spring-loaded bumpers on top to prevent spools from occasionally trying to jump out, and flexible filament guides that should help to minimize wear. Unlike the AMS 2 Pro or the ACE Pro, however, there is no built-in filament drying function. You do get RFID filament sync for Creality filaments though, and I haven't seen this before, but it also shows you the remaining filament for each spool. This is really handy if you ask me. Anyway, enough chit chat, let's print some stuff and see how it goes. The first thing I printed, like usual, was some of my Maker coins. And they're good, except for the top layer. The default print profile looks like it struggled with completely filling in all of the gaps on top, and a lot of printers do struggle with fine details like this, but usually not this bad. I'll come back to this point later. The next few things I printed were some accessories for this IKEA pegboard. I just moved into a new apartment, so please excuse the mess, and mounted it above my little entryway bench thing here. So I printed this long tray for knickknacks, and a heap of little hooks for even more knickknacks. I did need to cut out some huge chunks for the intercom and light switches. I couldn't find my tools because I just moved, so instead I kind of just hacked away at it with some tin shears, which is why this looks so rough. But my plan is to measure it up, design a facade of sorts, print them out, and it should clean it up and hopefully look good. Maybe. I haven't actually done this yet while I'm recording the script, so let me know what you think. Next, I printed some add-ons for my Hoto tools. On this first design, I paused the print at a few different spots so I could place some magnets inside and then print over them. And then I just had to screw the parts together. On the second design though, I glued in the magnets separately after they were already printed, and also glued on the side pieces. And these prints all came out really well. The only nitpick is again the top layer, but only in these few sections here. The underside is also a bit rough, but that's almost entirely due to using organic supports, so that's on me. And I also printed this insert for my soldering iron so that I can keep them all together and organized. Over the course of making this video, I've worked on a few mini projects like the pegboard covers and custom inserts I just showed, and some weird, fun phone cases that I'll show you more of soon. And 3D printing is great for stuff like this, but sometimes you just need a little bit more. My at-home 3D printed Lego compatible phone case, for example, pretty cool, but I've also sent my designs off to PCBWay and they've made versions that I couldn't dream of making myself, like this absolutely gorgeous transparent version. My 3D printed car badge design, again, pretty cool, but I also uploaded it to PCBWay and asked for it to be made of metal and chrome plated. And yeah, it's beautiful. They've also 3D printed and machined a heap of other things for me, like this anodized aluminium AMS mount I designed, and the custom molds I used to recycle filament. So a big thank you to PCBWay for sponsoring this video, and make sure to check out the link in the description to save a few dollars off your first order. Also, just go and have a look at all the materials and processes they have available for manufacturing. They're so simple to use, and they've honestly saved me so much time and pain. Anyway, back to the video. When I was printing these, I swapped a roll of Creality filament over to a Bamboo Lab filament roll. Even though they both have RFID tags, they're only compatible with their respective systems. To my knowledge, there isn't an agreed upon open standard for this kind of thing yet, which at this point is just plain silly. But let's get back to printing. These are a heap of silly phone cases I designed for a collaboration I did with Rhino Shield a few weeks ago, and these were all printed with the standard 0.16mm layer height profile. The highlight here was definitely the Lego compatible case because the dimensional accuracy was near perfect. Lego bricks are so precise that it usually takes me a few attempts of really minor adjustments to get the clutch power just right. But this print was basically spot on the first attempt. And yeah, I'm happy with the quality of all of these cases. While I'm not blown away, they're good, solid prints with a few tiny exceptions. Like my Maker coins, anytime the top surface seems to be a complicated shape, the K2 Pro seems to struggle more than any of my other printers. I'm not sure how well this is going to pick up on camera, but the Lego case has gaps between filament lines, and the same can be seen on other prints as well. The biggest issue I encountered though was the nozzle sometimes colliding with what it was printing, which is not a small issue at all. I don't know if I caught it on camera, but while printing the chessboard case, the nozzle collided and snapped this piece here while it was traveling to the back of the printer to swap to a different color. Obviously, this is bad. The slicer should never generate G-code that does this, but if it does, the 3D printer should take steps to avoid any collisions. So something's gone wrong somewhere. Luckily, reprinting this took no time at all, but this really isn't something you'd want happening during a multi-day print. Oh, and literally an hour after this happened, an update came through. I have no clue if it fixed any of these issues, but I'm hopeful Creality will get onto it soon. And just for your reference, I only ran into these issues when doing a multicolor print in Print by Object mode. And the final thing I printed was a collar mount for a tracker for my cat. I did not have very much time to design this or get it printed, and I didn't feel like messing with screws or glue or anything. So I paused the print to embed the collar, then paused it again to embed the tag. My measurements were ever so slightly off, and I didn't think this was going to work, but the print managed to recover with only a few minor imperfections, which were entirely my fault. It is a bit bulky, but this collar is only for special occasions, and he doesn't seem to mind. Okay, so here are my really quick overall thoughts about the K2 Pro before you click off this video. First, it has good print quality, not amazing, but it's good. Second, the 300mm³ build volume is quite a bit larger than an average Core XY printer, but I found it still a nice overall size. Anything larger would probably be a bit too massive for an average user. Third, there were a few minor issues that I mentioned, but they should be fixable with some software updates or with some minor slicer tweaks. That said, this is honestly the best and most seamless experience ever made by Creality. I didn't run into any UI lag or glitches, and their slicer behaved like a slicer should. So it does seem like they've taken their earlier critiques to heart and improved where they needed to. And the same goes for the build quality. I think this design is great, it's solid, it's sleek, and only the weirdly placed USB port feels like an afterthought. Now, I only did a few basic multicolor prints because I mostly just use multicolor systems for convenience, but I ran into zero issues with it. So yeah, huge build volume, competitive price, smooth user experience, and good print quality. From my testing, I'm happy to say that it's reliable and isn't trying to do anything too fancy, and it's a damn good deal because of it. In my opinion, the K2 Pro is absolutely not a machine you should be overlooking. Like always, I'm going to keep using this machine, so please let me know if you have any questions or thoughts, and I'll try to get back to you. Cheers.